Good evening, everyone. My name is Candace Thompson-Zachary, Manager of Justice, Equity, and Inclusion at Dance NYC. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I am currently on the land of the Lenape and Canarsie in what is currently known as Brooklyn, New York. I am a non-disabled Black woman of Caribbean heritage. I am wearing a tan shirt, silver earrings, and an auburn Afropuff, and my background is a red wall with books and shelves. Thank you for joining us for this digital experience and for being adaptable in these challenging times. As we are at the mercy of technology, we want to remind you that there may be delays, sound issues, and changing circumstances that may occur during our time together. We invite you to extend grace and patience to each other as we manage this virtual landscape. Second, ASL interpretation by Sarah On and Brandon Kazan Maddox from LC Interpreting Services, as well as closed captioning services provided by Cara Dugas of the Viscardi Center, will be available throughout the entire event. Live transcription will be available via stream to text, and the link is already in your comments. Third, feel free to post in the comments section on Facebook with questions that you may have or comments that you may have for the speakers. We will be gathering them throughout and during the conversation. We will present the most relevant questions that time will allow. Fourth, in case we need to end this session due to disruption, you will hear us say abort three times and then end. We will resume within 5 minutes here on Facebook Live. However, today's session will include a 5-minute break that will be announced by the moderator. Lastly, we hope that you will help us to amplify today's conversation. Hit the share arrow at the bottom of this live to share the page, the conversation to your page. Repost, tag us, and share your takeaways on Twitter at DanceNYC, on Instagram at dance.nyc, and here on Facebook, dance/NYC, using the hashtag artists are necessary workers, hashtag DanceNYC live. And now we'll begin disability justice as the vanguard for recovery thinking. As a way of deepening our work and learning in racial justice, we regularly practice land acknowledgements at meetings and public convenings to recognize our country's violent history and its legacy in the space we occupy. This practice is currently under development with the guidance of Indigenous dance artist and activist Emily Johnson to ensure that we embody this allyship. This includes taking actionable steps towards reparations in this initial instance by nurturing relationships with local Indigenous and First Nations artists and organizations, and making pathways for Lenape artists and leaders to return to Lenape Hoking today. I would like to acknowledge that the city of New York is on stolen land, more specifically Lenape Hoking, the unceded homeland of the Lenape people, who are also recognized federally as the Delaware Nation of Oklahoma, Anadarko, Oklahoma, Delaware Tribe of Indians, Bartlesville, Oklahoma, Stockbridge Muncie Community, Bowler, Wisconsin, and in Canada, Muncie Delaware Nation, Moravian of the Thames First Nation, Delaware of Six Nations. The Lenape people are the original inhabitants and caretakers of this land and gave Manhattan Island its name, Manahatta, meaning hilly island or place we go to gather the wood for the bows. Additionally, as we are gathered digitally and inspired by Adrian Wong of Spiderweb Show in what is currently called Canada, I invite us to consider the legacy of colonization embedded within the technologies, structures, and ways of thinking we use every day. We are using equipment and high-speed internet not available in many rural Indigenous communities that at times leave significant carbon footprints, contributing to climate change that disproportionately impacts Indigenous communities worldwide. We acknowledge that changing these inequities are our shared responsibility, as are our roles in reconciliation, decolonization, and allyship. We recognize that as an organization based in New York City, we have benefited and continue to benefit from the systemic displacement and subsequent erasure of Lenape people and governance on their land. Please join me in taking a moment to recognize and reflect on the centuries of violence displacement, forced migration, and settlement here, as well as the centuries of resilience and leadership of all Indigenous and First Nations peoples on Turtle Island that have led to our presence and livelihoods in New York City today. Let's just take a moment of silence. Continuing our practice of recognition, we would like to name openly the legacies of the African slave trade, migration and immigration patterns, the disability rights and disability justice movements, and the LGBTQ plus fight for justice. These areas and tactics of oppression through which white supremacy and settler colonialism have enacted and sustained its power over time are not the only areas, but rather the main focuses of Dance NYC's ongoing historical acknowledgement practice and justice, equity, and inclusion strategy. We would also like to take a moment of silence in remembrance of the victims of COVID-19 around the world and to honor the unseen labor of the many people that continue to ensure the safety and well-being of our community in these times, including but not limited to frontline workers. Lastly, and certainly not least, we acknowledge and mourn most recently Justin Howell, Sean Monterosa, Jamel Floyd, Tony McDade, George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, Richard Brooks, and all Black people whose lives have been taken by the actions of white people, institutions, and systems, and the many accomplices, witnesses, and beneficiaries of white supremacy who have actively participated in or stood by and observed in silence. Over the past few weeks, we have also witnessed as a nation and city the palpable impacts that systemic racism has had on the lives of Black and Indigenous people, peoples of color, immigrants, disabled and immunosuppressed people, LGBTQ plus people, and people living in low-income communities and poverty impacted by COVID-19. White supremacy continuously manifests itself in violence at the hands of law enforcement and in interpersonal interactions, our government's response to COVID-19, and our cultural institutions. Let us take a final moment of silence. For those of you who are new to the organization, Dance NYC delivers 5 core services for the field: advocacy, action-oriented research, leadership training and convening, technological resources through our website, grant making, all to empower dance makers, cultural workers, build audiences, and strengthen the collective voice for the art form. Dance NYC works in alliance with the national organization Dance USA to drive local national synergies in dance service delivery. You can learn more about our programs at our website, dance.nyc. As some of you may know, Dance NYC launched a new campaign on May 14th, declaring loudly that artists are necessary workers. The campaign demands the acknowledgement, representation, and integration of dance and arts workers into the decision-making that will envision our future post-pandemic. Artists serve New York City at every level, leading tourism, strengthening education, fueling the economy, and ensuring our health, wellness, and imaginations. So far, as part of this campaign, we have released the Artists Are Necessary Workers campaign video, which I'm sure many of you have seen by now, featuring members of our dance community displaying our strength and power in numbers, written a letter, and are now working with the Mayor's Office of New York City to insist on dance having a seat at the table. And lastly, we have curated this series of public conversations with arts and dance workers to discuss challenges, offer considerations, and envision our way forward as a field. Today's event will focus on unpacking the practice of disability justice as we consider how our many ecosystems can and should function post-pandemic, and how disabled artists and activists are practicing disability justice in their work. I'm pleased to welcome our moderator, Alice Sheppard, who will lead us in some opening remarks and then introduce the rest of tonight's panel. Alice, are you there?
Hi, Candace. I most certainly am.
Great. I'm so happy. It's all yours now.
Wonderful. I'm Alice Sheppard, and I am a light-skinned, multiracial Black woman. I am seated in my living room with a white wall as a background and some art on bark, fishes and birds in the background of me. I'm wearing a red sweater, a gray net piece, and I hope you can see my bright red lipstick, because that matters. I am in the Santa Cruz Mountains, or at least what is currently known as the Santa Cruz Mountains. It is the land of the Ohlone and the Moequa Ohlone people. I acknowledge my part and place in colonial and settler injustices, and I wish to be held to account as I work to make change. We're gathered for, I believe, the next 90 minutes to talk about disability justice as a vanguard in recovery thinking. And when I saw this request come up in my email, my first thought was, oh, yes, and then followed by, oh, no, 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 no. And then, oh, well, maybe, but let's get the right people in to really begin and lead this conversation. So if Candice and Dance NYC could bring on the amazing panelists and speakers, Christopher Núñez, Dustin Gibson, and Simi Linton, we can get started. I see Dustin coming on, I see Simi, and I see Christopher. Is everyone here? And can you all introduce yourselves for a second? Simi, I'll start with, you're on my left on my screen, so I'll start with you, and then for Simi, Christopher, and Dustin.
Hi, I'm Simi Linton. I am a white woman with gray fading into reddish brown hair. I'm sitting in my office with a bookshelf behind me. I am very delighted and moved to be here in this conversation. I am currently in Manhattan, in the land of the Lenape, and I recognize how beholden we are to them for use of this land, even though it has never been fully acknowledged. Dustin?
Hey, what's up?
I'm Dustin Gibson. I have a red St. Louis hat on with headphones. Brick wall is behind me. I'm a light-skinned Black man. I have what I would refer to as a quarantine beard. I have a white t-shirt with the words Free Josh Williams on it. Josh is still serving an 8-year sentence from his participation in the Ferguson Rebellion. He's the last remaining political prisoner from the Ferguson uprisings. So I do want to lift that. I am currently occupying Pequannock land. I'm in Hartford, Connecticut, which also is the site where Black bodies, Black people, were stolen from Africa, and insurance companies were built in order to insure them, which remains one of Connecticut's largest industries. So I want to acknowledge all the ways in which we occupy the land and its complications, and also say that disability justice is an entry point to possibly doing some decolonization work within ourselves and our larger community. So it's about the acknowledgement and also the commitment forward as well. Maybe can I invite Chris on?
Thank you, Dustin, and hi, everybody. My name is Christopher Núñez. I am currently an uninvited habitant in the Lenape Canarsie land, currently known as Flatbush in Brooklyn. I identify as a visually impaired choreographer, performance artist, educator, immigrant, based in New York City. My gender pronouns are he, him, his. I am 6 feet tall. I am a Latino guy. I have a beard. I shave my head. I have big brown eyes, big eyelashes. Behind me, there is a blue and gray wall. There is a mirror that you can probably see in the reflection of your screens. And I'm wearing an off-white, maybe oatmeal color. long sleeve thermal shirt. And if you want to think about the color oatmeal or off-white, think about the flavor of the oatmeal in the morning. It's made of cotton and it feels very light and soft against my skin. I also want to tell my friends on Facebook Live that I'm not always looking at the screen because I'm a visually impaired person. And as my dear colleague, Yel Palumpis, once told me, it is very exhaustive to pretend that you're looking at people when you can't see them. So I'm just focusing on listening to your powerful words, but I'm here, present. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you. Welcome, and welcome to everyone on Facebook Live. We're thrilled that you're here. I'd like to gather us together for a second. We're here until 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, which is where I am. I'd like to invite us to take a moment to notice where we are today, now. Just gathering ourselves in the recognition that things are not easy and that we don't have to leave behind who and what we are and who and what happened in order to participate in this event at this moment. So I invite you to take a moment to gather, notice who and where you are now. And in that presence, also gather, notice the questions, the curiosity, the ideas, the familiarities, the wish to learn, the challenges, the provocations that you bring to this conversation. This is not a top-down sharing of information. This is a community gathering and learning. So what brought you to this space? And I'd like to ask us to stop. Take a second and take a breath. In our preparatory calls, we outlined a series of like a trajectory or an arc of where we might go. And in the name of sharing this scaffolding so we know where we are, where we start and where we're heading, let me just give you some of that overview. The first thing we wanted to do is really spend some time pushing it back against the title. And the reason that came about was because we're concerned about the use of disability justice as a phrase and not as a reality. So we moved from pushing back against the title to really offering some discussion of what is disability justice. At that point, I think it might be a good idea to take a break. Gather some of the learnings, do what you need to do. Then we will come back. And when we come back, what we'll be talking about is what is disability justice in artistic practice? And we'll be thinking about dance, disability justice, and disability identity, the fullness of ourselves as part of our conclusion. We recognize that you will need to come and go throughout the course of this conversation. Please do that, do what you need to do. Please also be aware of yourselves in this moment. We spend a lot of time staring into our screens and there's a certain kind of physicality that goes with that. I invite you on your screens to stretch and move and do what you need to do in your bodies. I will be doing that. I just moved my arms, I just stretched, I just twitched. Please be your fullest embodied selves as we advance in this conversation. So now I turn it over to my colleagues to consider what is it about this title? Where do we want to start? Disability justice as the vanguard of recovery thinking. So let's start in the place of complexity around that. What is this thing, recovery, that people are talking about? What does disability justice mean here? And over to you, Christopher, Dustin, and Simi.
This is Christopher speaking. Thank you, Alice. As an immigrant, I have a different relationship to the language. When I think about restorative thinking, I was thinking more in the meaning of the words in Spanish. And so I thought, well, I really need to go back to the dictionary and maybe see what it means you know, the real term, the meaning of the words. And so the first line that I read was a return to a normal state of health, mind, or strength. And so I thought, well, that sounds very problematic because I understand the baggage in terms of the medical model of disability and what it means to restore something. But then as I continue reading, I found this beautiful definition that says the action or process of regaining possession or control of something stolen or lost. I wasn't born disabled. I became disabled when I was 5 years old. My father was an incredibly violent person. And so I am, my disability is the result of domestic violence. And so a lot of the decisions that were made for me and my life after that terrible accident were really made by people around me. They were never made by me. And so I went through a very arduous and ableist social training process to learn how to survive in the non-disabled world. I became partially blind and my central vision in my left eye was very deteriorated. So I needed to learn how to navigate the space. I needed to learn how to read books. I needed to learn how to do day-to-day activities. But instead of that, I was trained to hide my disability. It was very important for the people around me, my family, to hide my disability. And so I feel that for many, many years as a disabled child, as a disabled teenager, as a disabled artist, I was taking away so many things from my identity. I was always told that my feelings, that my questions, my request for justice was never heard. And I just feel that in many senses, my pride in my disabled body was taken away. I was considered what people call invisible disability. So people also didn't notice my disability right away. And so a lot of people questioned that. And when I requested something because I simply couldn't see, it was just totally out of control for me. People were really questioning the fact that I was disabled and they were even suspicious that I wanted to get some benefit. And so my desire to explain how I perceived the world was completely truncated and frustrated. Even my relationship to religion and God is very conflictive right now because I was always taught that my disability was a punishment. And so now I am 40 years old. I've been in New York City for 7 years. I have met many colleagues in the disability arts movement, and we all feel the same. We're all coming out of the closet. We're finally in that point in our lives that we want to take back and claim back our disability identity. And so I thought it was a beautiful way of maybe find another way to understand restorative thinking. And it's just claiming back identity, remembering, collecting experiences, processes. I'm collecting photographs. I'm going back to my notebooks. I'm trying to remember how I became a professional dancer, with no supervision, no mentorship, no community, working in isolation. How did I make it happen? And just put that process into my creative practice is recuperating everything that I think was taken away from me and put it back into the studio. So I understand the baggage of the restorative meaning, the meaning of the word. And I'm being very careful here and also very gentle because as an immigrant, I feel that I'm also looking at the situations and the practices and the community from a little distance, is still trying to understand the historic background of language and how we use language. and I'm learning the language. So I want to be careful and just listen and learn. But I thought it was a beautiful way to put what my practice and some of the colleagues that I've been talking to in the community feel and think about restoration or healing in some cases.
Thank you. Yes. Can I pull a series of threads here? That was really to catch some of that. Some of the ideas about recovery, which is different from healing, which is different from cure, which is different from wellness, and really ask about, really take that up and notice what the impact here for a disabled person is, because you cannot do this work as a rhetorical thing. Disability justice is not a checkoff. It involves the fullness, as Christopher just described. Thank you. Simi, Dustin?
Dustin, before you talk about disability justice, I'd just like to underscore the time that Christopher was talking about the repudiation of the medical model and the need to understand recovery as a medicalized term and the inherent ableism in that as take you back to where you were before as an ideal rather than take you to a new place. But Dustin, please take it from there.
This is Dustin. I do want to warn folks that I'm going to mention some violence. So as you need to, you can exit the conversation, come back. I just want to put that out there. First, when I'm thinking of recovery, the thing that comes to my mind in this moment is Toyin Salau, who was found murdered after being assaulted in Tallahassee, a young Black woman activist. I'm thinking about people like Tony McDade. I'm thinking about folks like Ahmaud Arbery and George Floyd and the literally countless people that have been taken in by the state, right? Have been stolen from us by the state, the majority of them being disabled people. And I'm thinking about that as something that has continuously happened since the US project began. So when I think about recovery, it's what are we recovering and what are we going back to? So as Christopher offered, it feels like there's that one entry point where we think about getting back ourselves. But for me, it feels like very much in this moment, the language of the state as far as economic recovery, it feels very much like after Hurricane Katrina, what does recovery look like in Mississippi and Louisiana, right? Where disabled people are disappeared to nursing facilities, where people are left for dead in jails and institutions and prisons. And that's all a part of the economic plan to recover as well. So I know, historically, I know that disabled people and other folks that are marginalized are not a part of the plans to recover. So disability justice is somewhat conflict with that, right? Disability justice is this, not just a practice, but it's something that we could also implement, right? So it's a praxis, praxis. And it's how we interact with the world and how we navigate it. And one of the things that it offers us is a grounding in its principles, being anti-capitalist. That one important in this moment to think about putting profit above people. And this is what the state, this is what systems, and I'm using systems here broadly, attempt to do, and disability justice is combating that, right? It's also anti-imperialist. So it's bringing in some of these larger connections. So I just mentioned people that were murdered by police, and disability justice allows us to see the connections between the police and the military, using the infliction of disability as a tactic of war, right? So all of those things that disability justice brings together for me is very helpful to think through this moment and not just think about what we could do after it, right? It feels like a lot of the public discourse is about how do we get through this to another end, back to either a status quo or back to a new future. And for me, it feels very important to just sit with this and think about how disability justice can inform what we're doing right now, because that actually is the work, right? If we're reaching and striving for a future at all times, then we won't have one if we're not building it as we go. And disability justice helps us do that because it's centering access, right? Rather than providing individual accommodations for people, we're thinking about how do we build access out. So when we do get to that point, all of us are there and we're not leaving other folks behind.
I also think that the title, Disability Justice as the Vanguard of Recovery Thinking, is the tension that we're talking, that I think we're going to be talking about, which is that disability justice could be at the vanguard, could be at the front, could lead a lot of the restructuring in meaningful ways, but our collective fear is that it will not lead. And I reiterated the word recovery. I take it back, of re-entry, which is what I've been calling it.
Can I gather those thoughts for a second? So if you're just joining the conversation, we are in the middle of discussing like what does disability justice in the as the vanguard for recovery thinking mean? And what is it and what is it not? And so I think part of what's coming out of the conversation, and I think if you is a recognition that if you aren't familiar with disability justice, that disability justice is a very clearly is a specific practice that is not the inclusion of disabled people. It is not disability rights, though disability rights as defined by the regulations of the Americans with Disabilities Act are necessary a small part. Disability justice is not that. It is a very separate thing. And so it's not something that you can just kind of swap the word or swap the phrase out of. So if you're new to disability and you're new to what this might be, we encourage you to really dig into understanding what Dustin just said, is that disability justice is a very specific praxis. And that it is, as Christopher described it, it entails a certain kind of approach towards identity and wholeness and recognition. And it entails certain principles towards thinking through capitalism and access and the ways in which we build relationship with each other. In particular, Dustin, I am reminded again and again and again of your closing sentence that no one gets left behind. Can you deepen into that a little bit, Simi, Christopher, and Dustin, just to sort of so that people who are coming into the conversation who may not know what disability justice really is, and how we got there or why we're here, so that information can be shared as well.
Hey, this is Dustin. Maybe I could offer like this part about no one being left behind. I think about like enslaved Africans working fields and singing songs to a certain rhythm. And the reason that they're singing it to that rhythm is that no one gets left behind, that no one is either picking too much crop or not picking enough crop so they can avoid punishment, right? So I think about those as practices of disability justice. That's an access-centered practice that allows no one to be left behind and ensure that we're all coming together. That's one of the things that I'm thinking about. It's also important to note that disability justice is developed by people out of that lineage, right? So it's building upon generations and generations of knowledge and practice and wisdom. And then it's articulated by Black and Brown, queer and trans and non-binary folks, right? Predominantly. And the risk of co-option, as Alice just talked about, is very real. These terms become a part of the academy, they become a part of institutions, they become a part of foundations, and then they lose what they are. And that's very easy to do when we're thinking about who holds power within certain institutions and systems. So in the same ways in which prisons are now running restorative justice programs, when you literally cannot run restorative justice without it being a voluntary practice, shows us how it could be co-opted. So I say that to say just the labeling of things as disability justice is something that I caution against, and I like always hesitate when I see things, because for our people, and when I'm speaking of our people, marginalized folks, it has been a way to connect each other. It's been a way to find each other, and it's been a way to discover disability in a way that is not using the Western language all of the time. English is a very limited language as far as expressing our emotions, our experiences, all of these things, and all colonial languages are in that regard. So having it articulated by oppressed people provides a different dimension that allows for the people that have been excluded and always been excluded, right? Like when we think about disability rights, because it's not a justice model, it is delineating between who is disabled and who is not based off of a white-centric understanding of what disability is, which totally erases, well, not totally, but erases a lot of the experiences and how we come to disability, how we experience disability. So I just want to add that to the importance of what Alice said, adding on to not replacing disability with disability justice or disability rights with disability justice, or just disabled people being present somewhere as some act of disability justice, right? We're not attempting to find ways for disabled people to become oppressors. We're not attempting to find ways for disabled people to have more privilege. We're like, we're actually interested in like breaking down privilege so it's not possible, right? Or no need for representation or no table, as we talk about, rather than like having a seat at the table, just no table at all, and then figuring out what access looks like. Some people need them, some people don't.
I'm laughing because this is the meat. This is the work. This is Alice. Simi, I noticed your mic is up.
My mic is up on.
Yeah.
Is it on?
As in on, yes.
Okay. Simi, as is her wont, has prepared a couple of things that she wants to say. So I'm going to get those out of the way and then jump in the conversation in various places. But there were a couple of things that I thought belonged here. One, I'm going to harken back to what I just said a few minutes ago, that in our very title, I think is embedded the tension, which is that I am thinking about, which is disability justice at the vanguard of recovery thinking. Will it or won't be? Won't it be at the vanguard? And what would help it be and what hinders it? So if that is a framework, let me say just a few things about all of this. Disability justice in two of its component parts, access and equity, are aspirational goals. There can be no such thing as full access or real equity as long as ableism, racism, and a host of other isms hold sway over our thinking and practice. We aspire not simply to desegregation as an antidote to segregation, we aspire to integration, equity, and ultimately justice. And in that, it is important, and Dustin has, I've learned so much from Dustin and from Sir H.R.L. Johnson and T.L. Lewis and others about the distinctions between disability rights and disability justice, and what is critically important about disability justice that is not addressed in a disability rights modality. And in order for the arts to help shape and direct these aspirations, if we understand these as aspirational goals, arts organizations and policy initiatives need to focus on the way that ableism structures every element of their work and not merely check off the ways they comply with external mandates for access. And compliance with external mandates for access is the rights-based model. The much lauded Americans with Disabilities Act is an important element in the emergence of disabled people, but it is only a small piece of it. And in order for the arts to help shape and direct these aspirations, the arts must focus on ableism and not solely on disability. And artists must actively think about the ways their body, and this is a different thought. Artists may be actively thinking about the ways that their bodies and modes of functioning are generative forces in their art, but unless they also consider the ways their bodies and modes of functioning are perceived and structured in society, it is an incomplete endeavor. I welcome the way that disabled artists are increasingly articulating what disability brings to their arts practice. I'm now asking us to focus on how ableism is structuring that practice and that presentation of self and that engagement with the art. So those are some things that relate to this past part, and I have other things to talk about as we go on, but I wanted to bring in that piece of it because I think that was germane to this conversation.
This is Alice, and I want to do two things. Actually, I want to do three things because there's a ton of really amazing questions coming up and comments in the Facebook live stream that I just want to put to you all as panel. And I also want to like bring these things together because they are directly germane to the questions. So, I mean, I think Dustin, you know, if you're the divide line here about what the ADA does in determining who and who isn't disabled, and what they can expect, rights and accommodations they can expect on top of it, is very different from what disability justice does. Insofar as disability justice surfaces the stories, as Christopher did right at the very beginning, surfacing the stories of how and why we come to disability, how we are in disability, how we live in disability, and how we live in community with each other in disability and in our work and in our artist practice. If you do not understand the distinction between disability rights and disability justice, This is the fundamental piece of the puzzle. And as then as all three panelists have pointed out, the role of access and the move toward equity and onto justice as it affects so many different parts of the life, as Justin was explaining, from the field through to the prisons, through to, and here we are in Facebook, a pile of questions saying, one from Christine asking, how can we find ways to center disability justice in reentry thinking, specifically as it relates to arts practices? From Robert McRura, loving the conversation, what role can dance in particular play in disability justice? And some sort of cheering us on from April as well, imagining and dreaming what is possible. What if there is no table to have to find access to? So I think we are really heading into complicated space. And I really love the direction that we're going in, because this is part of why we are here. Many of you out there are dance artists and are dance cultural arts workers, as well as activists and organizers and movers. And so there's a conversation about what disability justice is and why should dance actually be thinking about disability justice now. Dustin, Simi, Christopher, gonna toss this over to you to begin with, and then we're gonna have a good run at that, and then take a moment to take a break. So let's get started on this part of the work as well.
Thank you, Alice. This is Christopher speaking. I think it's a very interesting aspect of the conversation when we're talking about intersections. I am an immigrant. I was undocumented for 4 years in the US, surviving as a disabled person undocumented in the US. It's a nightmare, it's hell. And surviving the US as a disabled person documented is also a nightmare and hell. It's not easy. And the process is specifically under this administration in which your disability identity can be used as a political weapon to deny or decline the most basic rights, and how the other intersections in my life and in others people's lives, queerness, LGBTQ+, thinking about the identity and how it could potentially be used against you. And thinking about what Simi, I'm trying to land in many places at the same time. I think this my brain is just bubbling right now. I'm thinking about the practices, and I'm thinking about the functional compliance and the ADA, and as we talked before, I'm thinking about the dynamics, differences and similarities between autonomy, independence, and isolating, and to a certain point, loneliness in the life of disabled people in the US. And I'm just thinking that a lot of these compliances, a lot of these functional compliances, yeah, it the space can be accessible, the measurements of the doors, the elevators, the bathrooms, braille signs, it might be present in the space and it makes the space accessible, but that doesn't mean that as disabled artists, we're not feeling isolated. So we're still creating work in isolation, even if we have the access to the spaces. And so the conversation goes beyond the practice in the space or as the space, the architecture of the space, the structure of the space, but how we build community that understands what disability justice is and how we as artists use that as an aesthetic in itself. How do we make the process part of the aesthetic at the same time? I'm just thinking about the experience of the process and the freedom to have an open-ended and where capitalism comes in place when we're talking about making art and art as a product and productivity and how many hours we go to rehearse and how we take advantage of the space. And, you know, sometimes I feel now that when I get a residency, when I get an opportunity, when I get a space, institutions are expecting me to resolve the world and to provide solutions for them, for the society. And they're expecting me to have the absolute answer for accessibility. And all I want to do is my process. I just want to celebrate my process. I just want to build community. I just want to be present in a space. And so I'm thinking about, you know, in my practice specifically, the center insight, again, capitalism and how they come up with the numbers for what successful means. And yeah, but if you're making work that is the center insight, how many people are interested in that? So we keep measuring or creating these measurements for what successful looks like in the arts and how many people are going to be impacted and how many people are going to come and see you. Maybe I don't want anybody to see my process. Maybe I'm just a studio artist and maybe I just want to do my own research around it. So I'm thinking about all of these things as political weapons and political statements for rejection, for discrimination, not only from, you know, it's taking it to governmental, you know, immigration departments, but also taking it to nonprofits and arts organizations. Thank you.
Thank you.
So this is Dustin. As Christopher was talking, I was just thinking about what it means for art to live and embody what disability justice is. And I keep thinking about Yo-Yo Lin's Resilience Journal. And as somebody, Yo-Yo, with chronic illness, to be able to create something tangible in a different way, to see her illnesses outside of her body, outside of her mind, and then what that looks like for other people, non-disabled people, to engage with that. That's a part, it's like part and parcel of learning. It's also learning about self and the disabled experience. It's learning about how to undo ableism. Like, there's really important things that come from that. And it feels like, because it's an embodiment of disability justice, it allows for those things. Also, one of the things I wanted to respond to, which Alice said, the separation between the rights and the justice-based model, just in its definition that's given to us by the Rehab Act and the Americans with Disabilities Act, it concedes that disability is an impairment, right? disability justice is combating that by talking about it is something that is a natural part of the human experience, something that has always existed, right? Regardless of how many times the state has attempted to erase disabled people from our history, and the fact that people are disabled. And one of the things that it's missing, although it does give us certain levels of access to the physical world, some of the big things that it's missing is this idea that disability is not the stagnant definition, that it's this one thing that happened, it's this one injury that people acquire, it's this one thing that you're born with. And because it's viewing it as stagnant, the way that we respond to it is also very stagnant, and it's individual accommodations for individual people. So the big part of disability justice is articulated by like Patty Byrne. It talks about collective liberation and collective access. And that collectivity is very important when we're thinking about how do we respond to access. So oftentimes institutions or collectives, organizations, just people in general are attempting to implement practices of disability justice into whatever they're doing. And they are looking for some rights-based response that provides them a checklist of all of the things that we need to be well and whole and full. When in reality, that is an impossible task. Our access needs collide with each other, they conflict. It requires a different type of relationship between us and the world and animals and all of the things, because we have to be attentive to each other, right? Disability is something that's very fluid. Like we go in and out of it. How we experience it is different depending on the day, the time, where we're at. It's also not happening in a vacuum. So one of the biggest lies that I was sold, at least, was I am disabled and I will have these experiences because I'm disabled, but not telling me that the environment around me shapes that as well. So when I'm thinking about being disabled, it also matters that I'm Black. It also matters that I grew up in a trailer court. It also matters that I might be first generation literate on one side, right? Like all of those things play into how I experience the world, and our response to that should also factor in those other things as well. So when I think about access, it's something that we are literally working on in the moment, and it's not something that we could have some checklist for, because it's much more expansive than the law has given us credit for.
Thank you, Dustin. This is Simi. And I also just want to say that I realized when I was describing myself, I forgot to say that I identify as a disabled woman and I'm a power wheelchair user. Not visible because I'm only from the shoulders up here, but important to how I relate to the world. But when you were talking about access and how we're constantly negotiating that, Dustin, it brings to mind experiences that I've had, many experiences that I've had when I am in an environment that is majority disabled and led by disabled people. And the difference between that and being in an environment where as well-meaning and as thorough as an organization is in providing access, the difference in the feel and the experience of access is amazing to me. In the disability dominant and disability led organizations, we experience access as relational. You know, if I, as a wheelchair user, if I need more space to turn around and there's a blind person with a guide dog sitting behind me and, you know, et cetera, the way that we negotiate constantly, because it's interpersonal. It's not something that you can provide with a checklist. And that doesn't mean that we don't have sign language interpreters, which you can check off on the list, and we don't have audio description. It does mean that we have to be much more thorough and creative and balance out and negotiate constantly what we mean by access. And I think that the arts is, to jump back to the topic at hand here, I think that the arts is a wonderful way to reveal that the relational nature of access. And that is something that we can emphasize and push for.
This is Alice. Wow. So I'm just gonna say it is 3:27, 6:27, which means that it is probably time for our 5-minute break. I'm gonna pull together the strands of that conversation from Christopher talking about what would it mean to have access in a creative process. We're gonna come back to that, Christopher, and ask you to talk a little bit more about actually how that shows up in your dance making process. And Simi talking about, Simi and Dustin both talking about the distinction between an interdependence, Christopher, and isolation and relationship, interpersonal access, and also access not as a series of check boxes that you can get from an ADA, and also the relationship between knowing this work, being in this work, asking the disabled artist to provide you with a checklist when they show up. So there's a series of threads coming out of it that I think we can begin with when we come back. So it is 3:28, 6:28, and in between probably 4:28 and 5:28. Let us resume our conversation in 5 minutes time at 7:24, 7:25, 6:24, 6:25. And thank you for all of this work. See you soon.
All right, folks. I'll put a title slide up so that you'll know that we're still waiting, and then we'll be back in a few minutes.
Hi, everyone. And we are back. Welcome back.
I'm able to start my video, FYI.
I think we can figure that out for you, Simi.
Okay.
Is everyone back? Yep, looking good. Yeah, wonderful. Okay, welcome back, and thank you for being here in this conversation. We just took a 5-minute break to gather and collect all of our thoughts and to take some perspective on what has happened and to prepare for the last minutes of this conversation. If you're just joining us, I kind of feel like an NPR host every time I say that. If you're just joining us, we have been talking about disability justice in the vanguard of recovery thinking. And we have talked a little bit about the problems with recovery and maybe offered re-entry as a separate kind of word. We've talked a little bit about the distinction between recovery and health and well-being and what disability means. We've covered the distinction between disability rights and disability justice, and we have modeled in our practices some of the things that disability justice allows for and have to distinguish between the rights accommodation model and the disability justice of working towards access and equity. And we have named some of the disability justice founders as mainly articulated by Patty Byrne, thank you, Dustin, and also noted that disability justice is very different from the white disability rights model. The justice model is, the justice praxis versus a model, is led by Black, Brown, Queer, Trans, and BIPOC folk, and it is a movement that is recognizing that's in the search for equity and a different approach to access and really welcoming the fullness of all of us. So if you are on Facebook Live, you can send your comments and questions to us. We can see that document. And as Candice said at the beginning of the talk, those questions get fed through to us and to me, and I will bring them up and put them to the panelists. So you can be a part of this conversation, and we welcome your participation in that particular way. We left it in the middle of some rich and complicated stuff. And that was specifically about what does access mean and why it's not a checklist of accommodations. And in particular, Christopher, you were beginning to talk about what does it mean to actually have an accessible process. And with that, I would add, what does it mean to, as a question, what does it mean to make access a creative aesthetic? So I think we are in the space of noticing that the ADA, the accessible accommodations, are often institutional. They tie to presenters, funders, galleries, museums, theaters, studios, organizations. But this disability justice praxis of access and the equity that we are in search of, striving for, speaks to us all, implicates us all as artists, and that it is not an institutionalized practice. And so one of the questioners asked was, well, how does dance take up disability justice? And I think I would want to turn it over to Christopher, to Dustin, and to Simi to dive right into all of these questions. Please keep the comments coming, and we'll bring them in. I don't know, Christopher, Dustin, Simi, who wants to start?
Thank you, Alice. This is Christopher. Wow, that is such a powerful and a strong question. And I'm trying to think back. Well, we are in this moment in which if we are talking about white supremacy and dismantling white supremacy, we need to start talking about the white supremacy practices in our dance studios, in our dance programs. Thinking about white supremacy as an absolute aesthetic and as an absolute concept of beauty. And thinking about my own training as a dancer and how everybody told me to be a dancer, you had to suffer. Disabled body, non-disabled people, everybody has to suffer. So I think this white supremacy model in our dance programs is not only hurting terribly and discriminating terribly our disabled people, it's also destroying non-disabled people. I just remember, you know, if it's hurting, it's because it's doing good to your muscle. And so when I came to New York, I started to hear people. I remember Mana Hashimoto and I remember Kayla Hamilton, and they were talking about healing and healing processes, and I was thinking, what are they healing for? I mean, what happened here that people needs to be healed? And I just didn't realize how intrinsic that violence and that discrimination and that suffering in the name of making art was so present in my body. I think reentry as a dance practice, as a dance aesthetic in disability is an attempt to represent the disability culture, the disability body in the arts. I think the process of discovering how to dance with a disabled body is beautiful in itself. And I think all these wonderful accessibility tools, they're beautiful, but there is so much potential in them. We just see them as solutions. We don't see them as aesthetic and solutions at the same time. We just see them as a side. We just see them as a complement instead of being embedded in the process. And I'm just thinking about the potential for audio description and not only using words, but making sounds. And I'm thinking about the tactile design for dancers. And I think how funny that Krishna Washburn or Mana Hashimoto were also using tape to create tactile surfaces on the floor so we could feel with our feet and create beautiful patterns and shapes using only tape. The presence of the body, the publicness of the body, people don't want to see disabled bodies. And I think that's one of the reasons that want disabled people to be in public. And by presenting ourselves, it's already a political statement to stand on the stage presenting your disabled body, the publicness of the disabled body, as a beautiful aesthetic in itself. This is all disability culture. But then again, as an artist in the middle of my process and rediscovering, coming out of the closet, I don't know where the process of disability arts begins and where disability culture intersects and where healing processes and where therapy starts. And, you know, but I think it's all what's beautiful about the process, and that is aesthetic in itself, is the collaborations. Collaboration as an aesthetic is also so important in the disability arts. Just thinking about, I'm going to end it here because I don't want to say anymore. I want to end it here because I don't want to ruin what I said. So that's what I'm thinking right now.
While those comments settle with you, Christopher, and with everyone else out there, I'm going to come back, but for the moment, can I give just a shout out to who's in the space. I know that I've seen comments from April Biggs, Jonathan Washburn, Krishna Washburn, Mark Ramosa, Karen Kitchen from Common Ground Arts, Casey from Dance Wave, Catherine Gaynor, Kayla Hamilton, Carla Peterson, Tracy Lester, Chris Rudd, and Yo-Yo Lin. I mean, you know, you're all out there. Hello. And thank you for commenting, sending questions, and for really digging into the conversation here. I think I want to double back. This is wonderful. The ways in which ableism structure dance practice. Someone else is picking up, I think Shafflet is just picking up the suffer and obey, the idea that dance should be painful. You know, that there with no pain, I was told no pain, no gain, right? Which is in fact a rehab model. You know, I could be a physical therapist saying no pain, no gain, and also a dance teacher saying no pain, no gain. The two there are deeply connected for me. And so what I want to really do is think about this practice that that Dustin, Christopher, and Simi are really calling us into, is to recognize the ways in which the field is structured around ableism, and that disabled artists are doing a different kind of work, that disability culture, disability aesthetics, disability arts, and disability justice are working in the field transformatively at this moment. And that these artists that you're seeing and many others of us out there are changing the field in the way that we're doing our work, but also that this practice is an invitation to all of you making work, as well as the presenters, museums, gallerists, venues who have access to deal with the structural accommodations suggested by the ADA. We are getting really close to our time. We have just over 10 minutes. 10 minutes left, and there's a question from Christopher Baswell. Yes, we've been pushing back over recovery. And panelists, what do you think of the term resilience?
Well, I'd like to think about what fosters resilience in a title rather than what resilience itself. If we're all together in this re-entry, I guess we're thinking about re-entry in terms of re-entry into the social space, because we've already seen over the last 3 months that there is an entry into production of art that is exciting. So when we go back into the greater cultural space, what is it that will foster resilience? And why is that necessary? You know, I mean, I'm not disagreeing that it's necessary, but what will foster resilience?
This is Dustin. Not to just say like, hey, throw everything away, but I'm struggling with all of them, like re-entry, recovery, resilience, for what Simi just said about resilience. But I'm thinking about like people that are trapped in institutions, that are trapped in prisons, that are trapped in jails, places that are hot spots before COVID and after COVID for virus spread, for the development of different type of illness and disability. And what does it mean when we are in at least like a faux free world, talking about re-entering back into something, when folks will be leaving like a 6x9 back into a larger cage, right? So I struggle to think about any of these things is going back to something when I know that there are still people trapped regardless of if we come out on the other end of COVID, right? Even if we go back to the status quo, what does that mean for people in nursing facilities that are still trapped there? Those are just like some questions that are animating the way I'm thinking. I'm not saying throw it out, the baby out with the bathwater, but just to possibly think through it. Mm-hmm.
I am reckoning. I mean, seeing a reckoning with language, right? Mm-hmm. I really am seeing a reckoning here with language. That, and I think Christopher, you've been part of that reckoning from the top, you know, of this conversation, you know, pointing out about what the ways in which English does and doesn't work. And here we are. We do need to reckon with language because the words that we use will structure the world that we build. In this whatever the new era is whenever the new era starts. Maybe it started tonight, maybe it started last night, maybe it started 3 months ago. But we are in a moment of transformation, and language matters because those words will shape our futures. So it is worth being meticulous, as all of our panelists have, I think, in working through language and pointing out what it is and isn't doing for us. There are some comments coming up again on Facebook, and I just want to bring this back into the conversation as they go through. Partly a recognition of what is access as an aesthetic in the work itself, and really what's the subtext here is that artists are making work that is accessible in the creative process and in the work itself from the get-go, rather than adding access as a kind of accommodation afterwards. Mm-hmm. And that is a critical distinction between the rights model, where access gets added on afterwards later, if someone shows up, if someone registers 2 weeks in advance, to understanding that access is in the work, in the making of it. And that is the distinction between institutions and artists working together in that way that Dustin highlighted at the very beginning of no one gets left behind. Everyone is built into, we are built into the work. And so there are comments in the Facebook about audio description as its own art form. Absolutely, yes. And there are artists working all over the place. Kayla Hamilton, Shannon Finnegan, in particular, Christopher, your own work around description and access in and blind and non-visual dance. Yeah, Palumpas. New York in particular is a vibrant area in which audio description, David Linton, you know, the names are just sort of coming through, you know, it's becoming far more complicated than the actual functional description that is required by the ADA. People are thinking about what does it mean to have tactile forms? What does it mean for deaf and hard of hearing access to understand the ways in which sound travels? It's not just a question for sound to be felt, for tactile access, for haptic access, that disabled artists and deaf and disabled artists are working through the art form very, very differently. It's not just the addition of CART and ASL, as you might see on this call. A recognition here also in the Facebook comments that white supremacist aesthetics, the Western contemporary dance aesthetics, come from the exploitation of a hypermobile body. Mm-hmm. You know, the higher your leg goes, the better it is. Mm-hmm. And that very fundamental recognition, thank you, Audrey Wittanen, is to point through that there is a history of eugenic practices around hypermobility, and that hypermobility itself is often not identified as a disability in itself, and yet hypermobile bodies are so prized in the dance aesthetic. So there's also that going through. Thick marks. Can strategies for increasing access also be strategies for challenging white and ableist supremacy? So we are in it, and we are in it deep and hard at this moment. I think partly what I want to ask all my panelists as we move into our final 6 minutes is, you know, dance has this reputation for being an exclusive and elitist art form. This conversation that we're having is nowhere near this. And this is not our world. Can you tell us a little bit about dance as a justice practice in itself?
No. Whoops, who did we lose? Oh, there he is.
You're up, Simi. Your microphone's on it.
I know, and I said no because that wasn't the question I wanted to chew on. So let somebody else chew on that, and I have another direction to go in when you're ready for me. Go ahead.
I would say, unless anyone else wants to jump in, we are so closing in on the final minutes. So I think maybe it's just time to say what you need to say and like get it said, never mind my questions.
Okay, so here's what I want to say. since the lockdown began, I've been thinking a lot about what, and I'm going to call it reentry for now, is going to look like. And one of the things I think about is the gains that the disability arts movement has made over the last 3 years or so, and how I fear losing ground. And there's many things we could talk about that, but one of the things I'm starting to fear and feel is that in the culture, in the environment of fear in which we're all living, that there will be a backlash against the disabled body that has been glossed over, that anxiety has always been there, and that backlash and that aggression has always been there, something that we all have had to learn the hard way. But I think there could be a new level and a new era of aggression because of the climate of fear that we're living in. And it's something I want to be super alert to as we are socially with other bodies and non-disabled bodies, non-disabled people, and how that's going to feel. It's what's plaguing me right now, so to speak.
Dustin, Christopher, final words?
I just want to acknowledge people like myself, immigrants with disabilities, trying to fight a system that is ableist, trying to live in two different worlds. I look at my country, I look at this country, I see the advancements in the US, I see how far behind my country is, especially for artists with disabilities, and how white supremacy is so, so intrinsic into the culture that it's even impossible to start this conversation. So I just feel very, touched and very, very honored to learn to reestate my position as an artist and my identity, and to have this space to say something. Living in two different realities, trying to cooperate, and thinking about what Simi just said, and understanding that you know, there is a whole movement that is bubbling right now, but we're also a political statement, and people are scared sometimes of political statements. So thinking about how the practice can be of help in this moment, in this political moment. Thank you.
This is Dustin. One, I want to thank Alice and Simi and Christopher. This has been an honor to be a part of. What Christopher was just saying about this being a political moment, I'm thinking of Toni Morrison when she's like talking about all of the art stuff for the sake of arts is like bullshit and all good art is political. And thinking about how many, as Simi was talking about, how many people that will be disabled because of what's happening right now. And the importance of us being able to find each other, being able to find our people, being able to find our political homes, being able to understand ourselves through art. Art is one of the ways that we understand ourselves, right? Like Toni Morrison also talks about, it's not always what you say, but it's what you don't say. And I interpret that as me being able to comprehend the words of Zora Neale Hurston and Paul Laurence Dunbar, because they're speaking from the dialect that my family does. And how important that is for us to be creating things for us. And in this moment, it is very much so, not to put pressure on the entire disabled arts community, but it really feels life and death to me. That ability to be in community with one another, And then just to speak a bit to like that process of what it is to make, it feels like we have to make it in community, right? Like could be alone in our rooms making whatever it is, but we have to be speaking to someone. And it has been like a thrill to learn about other disabled artists speaking to disabled artists. And I am very new to it. But it's, yeah, I'll leave it at that. And hopefully that continues. So like Simi said, like all of those advances in the arts, if those things don't happen through institutions, then I hope in this moment that we realize through mutual aid, through all of the other things that we're keeping each other alive with, that we can do that ourselves outside of these places that really have never like wanted to hold us, never appreciated us, right? And really want to see us die in a lot of different ways through their actions. But
and thank you, Dustin, for all you just said. But to Dance NYC, which is an organization that brings disabled people together, and this is an example of that, something we desperately need now.
All right. Thank you, Simi, Dustin, Christopher. Your words, yourselves, and your heart, your commissions and passions tonight. Thank you.
And thank you, Alice.
Thank you.
Me too, Simi, yes.
To all of you out there who participated in Facebook or were just on this call, find us, reach out to us, connect with us, join us. We're findable and want you to be part of this conversation. One thing I do say about the new intersectional disability arts movement is that the work is made by disabled people. It features disabled people. It is rooted in disability aesthetics, politics, and culture, and it imagines disabled people as its primary audience. So just that. We are a massive and a wonderfully growing community that is contentious, provocative, loving, and care-filled, and I hope you will join us as we craft whatever new future. Crafting the future. No re-anything. Crafting this future, imagining this future.
I like that.
Together. Alrighty. It is 7:03, 4:03, and probably 5:03 and 6:03, somewhere in between those two places. Thank you for being here. And I'm going to call it.
Thank you, Alice. And thank you to the speakers for everything that you shared with us so wonderfully, and what you shared with our Facebook audience. A lot of us have been tuning in every week. So thank you to our audience that has stayed with us and the new people that we've welcomed by joining today's conversation. Our series continues next Tuesday, June 23rd at 5:30 Eastern Time. The title of next week's conversation is The Future of Performance Venues. We'll be chatting with Kathy Hung, the Executive Director of Jamaica Center for Arts and Learning, Fred Dixon, the President and CEO of New York City and Company, Janelle Prokofi, President and CEO of the Apollo Theater, and Linda Shelton, Executive Director of the Joyce Theater Foundation. We usually post any resources shared from today's event on the webpage, on our website, in the Facebook event page, and we'll send it in an email later on this week. So look out for that. There's also the post-event survey. So if you tuned in today, please share your thoughts with us so that we know what you enjoyed, what you might want to see in the future, and give us any feedback that would be useful. And we'd like to thank our friends at LC Interpreting and Viscardi Center for their accessibility services in ASL, closed captioning, and our stream to text today. Lastly, thanking the staff at Dance NYC for working behind the scenes every week to make sure that this series takes place. But that's all we have. So thank you, New York City. Thank you for all the people who are tuning in from various places in the world. And we'll see you next week.